Hey everybody, Reid here. Welcome to another installment of the Video Power Rankings. Today we're covering Standard, fresh off the release of Brothers War. Let's get into the top 10 decks. Coming in at number 10, we have Dimir. Not a deck that you likely would have run into in Dominaria United Standard, but it makes a lot of sense that this archetype is now possible thanks to the printing of Underground River. In fact, you don't even need any additional tapped lands like Rafine's Tower or Dismal Backwater, anything like that. This particular take on Dimir is sort of artifact-based, using Tezzeret, Betrayer of Flesh, which, by the way, is a sweet card that never really got its chance in the sun, at least not yet. We have Surge Engine, Reckoner Bankbuster, Bladecoil Serpent, and Phyrexian Flesh Gorger to support that and build in a small artifact theme while maintaining very high individual card quality. Cool deck because you get to mix the cheap permission of blue with the very effective removal of black and bring it all together into just a really well-rounded, nice deck. I would be eager to try Dimir. Coming in at number 9, we have Joda Legends. This is a 5-color deck that's made possible by Plaza of Heroes. Now, Plaza of Heroes helps you support 5 colors of mana as long as you're willing to choose most or all of your non-land cards to be legends. It's really not that hard in Standard because the extremely high creature quality, and you get to cap off at Joda the Unifier, which, in addition to being a standalone threat, is just going to make all of your creatures massive and help you deliver a killing blow over the course of 1 or 2 turns. Now, this deck is cool, it's fun, it kind of looks like a gimmick, like, you know, just for fun style of deck, but it actually can succeed and score wins at high levels of competition, so I would give this one a little bit of credit, and yeah, thanks to that key card, Plaza of Heroes, that really ties everything together. Coming in at number 8, we have Classic Esper Midrange. Now, this has been the best deck not only for a huge span of time during Dominaria United Standard, but really for all of 2022, Esper was a major deck to beat and something you always had to expect to run into when you entered a Standard queue or ladder match or tournament. Now, why has it fallen to number 8? It didn't have a big weekend, the first weekend out with Brothers War. I attribute that more to like lots of players just being excited to try the new cards and try out interesting archetypes and see what's possible in the format, and less of a case of Esper suddenly became really bad just because the new cards came out. I think this is one to keep an eye on, and probably once the dust settles on the new format and we reach more of an equilibrium, more players will choose Esper and it will continue to be, you know, a high win rate archetype. So I wouldn't count this one out. I would expect it to possibly rise higher in the power rankings in coming weeks. But for now, Esper is number 8, but still totally fine choice if this is something you want to stick with after liking it in the previous format. Speaking of decks that we liked in the previous format, I was already a big fan of Mono Black Midrange, and it's gotten some new weapons with Brothers War. This is coming in at number 7 for today. I would say the highlights are Phyrexian Flesh Gorger and Misery's Shadow, which are really, really sweet sort of scalable threats that you can cast early, but also maintain their value into the late game. Go for the Throat is generally an upgrade over Infernal Grasp, at least for the way the metagame is looking right now. But yeah, just good deck that got better in the new format, and this is something that certainly I would be going towards if I had a Standard tournament coming up. Number 6 is another deck that was already good and got better with the printing of Brothers War. This is Rakdos Sacrifice. So, of course, key card, as has been the case for a few months now, is Oni Cult Anvil. But you get to pair that with... well, actually, this list that I copied doesn't seem to have too many Brothers War cards, but there are a lot of new artifact options. You know, Brothers War is an artifact-based set, so you can choose from lots of cool stuff to supplement the Rakdos Sacrifice strategy, but the core of the deck remains the same. It's all about sort of generating incremental resource and life total advantages as the game goes long. leveraging Oni Colt Anvil, and you get to play, you know, high card quality, good disruption, good removal, while not really being vulnerable to spot removal yourself, since you have these engines that really don't rely on any key creatures sticking on the battlefield. So, sorry, one more thing about Rakdos is this wasn't a super popular deck from my research for this power rankings, but it did outright win one of the standard challenges on Magic Online this weekend, which is something I do give a lot of credence to. So this is one that I think could wind up being a popular choice among, you know, really strong, engaged standard players and might be a bit of an overperformer. So keep an eye on Rakdos Sacrifice, and perhaps don't be surprised if it takes even a higher spot in the power rankings in future weeks. Number five, another monocolor deck. This one is going to be mono white. Now, interestingly, this particular version has a bunch of off-color lands to facilitate the kicker on Archangel of Wrath. But the key here is that the white cards in standard are just awesome. Mono white aggro is a classic archetype that you often expect to be, you know, playable or successful in standard. But right now, I think you can make a very, very strong case that just a controlling or mid-range version of white is even stronger. So you use Ambitious Farmhand and Restoration of Igonjo to get your mana underneath you, sort of power the deck with Reckoner Bankbuster and Planeswalkers, Wandering Emperor, Elspeth Resplendent. And then you just bridge nicely into some combination of board sweepers, these powerful angels that win games, and then even the sideboard options give you additional flexibility if you want to go all the way up to something like Farewell. Yeah, mono white, really good deck. Overperformer, I think. Okay. Now coming in at number four, it is a different take on Esper. Esper Legends. So yeah, this deck is sort of a hybrid. Already on the power rankings, we've seen classic Esper midrange, and we've seen the Joda Legends deck fueled by Plaza of Heroes. This is sort of a marriage of those two strategies and has been performing, I think, better, at least right out of the gates, than either one of those. So you clean up the mana a bit. You have this nice curve out where you're often using Thalia, Guardian of Thraben, into either Raphine or Adeline Resplendent Cathar. That really just puts your opponent behind the eight ball and, you know, makes them scramble to catch up while their spells are being taxed and they can't use removal effectively to catch up and stabilize the situation. So again, just the quality of the legendary creatures in standard is so high that you don't really need to look much beyond them to build a great deck. If you're playing Esper rather than the five color version, you can play a handful of well-placed non-legendary spells, like this deck has Destroy Evil plus some permission spells in the sideboard. That definitely works. So again, just like a surprisingly well-rounded deck, but also with those brutal curve outs, Esper Legends is one of the better decks right out of the gates here with Brothers War. Coming in at number three, another monocolor deck, and another deck that I'm personally very interested in. This is Mono Blue. There's a time when I called this Mono Blue Delver, but players have sort of wised up that you can succeed either with or without Delver of Secrets. Personally, I kind of like Delver in the sideboard to keep the opponent honest and punish them if they take out too much of their cheap removal. But anyway, the idea here is that you use a small number of very potent cheap threats like Talarian Terror and Haughty Djinn, and otherwise you're just kind of drawing cards and countering everything the opponent plays. The incentive to stay mono blue is having tons of basic islands to support Thirst for Discovery, and a card that I'm very, very excited to play with is Flow of Ideas, Flow of Knowledge. Anyway, the card I'm talking about is 5 mana to draw cards equal number of islands you control and then discard 2. So I think that is a little expensive for this strategy, but just powerful enough that it can really, really help this deck perform well in longer games. That's number three. Moving to number two, brand new archetype with the release of Brothers War. It is Standard Soldiers. This is a tribal deck that is made possible by multiple tribal lords, Valiant Veteran from Dominaria United, and then Harbin Vanguard Aviator, and a number of other great soldier creatures from Brothers War. In the Trenches is a really cool card. It's like an upgraded version of Glorious Anthem, which was a card that was already really good and didn't even necessarily need an upgrade. But yeah, really cool stuff going on with blue-white soldiers. A lot of lists go as high as 4 mana for the Wandering Emperor. So sort of marrying old and new in terms of just card quality and really, really punishing aggressive creature-based stuff. You'll always see blue and white because the mana is just great for supporting the soldiers in both of those colors. You have Fortified Beachhead and a Darkar Wastes. And then sometimes you can add a third color. I've seen Bant soldiers performing pretty well also. Okay, that brings us to number one. It is Grixis Midrange, kind of a holdover from the previous format. Nathan Stoyer won the World Championship with Grixis, and then right towards the end of Dominaria United Standard, it really eclipsed everything else in terms of popularity and success at the tournament level. So I think some amount of Grixis being ranked number one this week is like a holdover as this being a go-to strategy for the previous format. But it is just still really, really good. And as you can see, picked up a couple of new cards from Brothers War, Go for the Throat, Brotherhood's End, and even additional top end options like that Blade Coil Serpent if you want to go that direction. So I don't think Grixis is like a dominant number one for right now. And there are a few decks that I wouldn't be surprised if they made a run for the title in future weeks. But for now, you really just can't go wrong. Grixis is tried and true. It's well-rounded. So great place to start for week one or week two of Brothers War Standard. All right, I hope you enjoyed this video. Let me know if there's any decks that you think are going to surprise me that I should keep an eye out for in coming weeks. And I will see you next time.